get up to the H-gas quality that Belgium has in most of its systems. Please comment, because I could have also asked about L-gas. So L-gas and Dutch gas are between 70 and 80% methane and other hydrocarbons. Okay, next question. Let's see if we have a winner already. Parachos, I hope I pronounced right. Frank is second. Frank VDZ, I think that I know who it is. Keistad, Kalle and Matti are close contenders. So let's see. It helps if you answer fast. The faster your answer, if it's right, the higher your score. Okay, next question. China has more than 30 million anaerobic digesters. Nepal has around 50,000. How many anaerobic digesters are on Antarctica? That is also international Antarctica. That's a bit far away. 16 seconds. Oh. Answers are coming in quickly. Rapidly. The internet, the station that you see on this photo is the Princess Elizabeth Antarctica Research Station, and it is a Belgian owned or Belgian managed station, and it aims to be zero emission. And the right answer is one, because that station that you just saw on the photo actually has an anaerobic digester. For me, it wasn't clear if they used the biogas, but they didn't say anything about renewal. They said a lot about renewable energy, but not about biogas. So I think that they don't use biogas in it. They're planning to use hydrogen fuel cells, but that is what I found on the website. I'm not working there. Would be a nice place to go. Most of the renewable energy in that station is actually from wind and even from solar panels. So solar panels are also used to melt the snow. Okay, let's go to the next question. Oh, first, of course, the scoreboard. Parachos, or Parachos in Dutch. You're leading the pack, and Frank is still close. And Matti, and Merle, and Korreltje are also following very well. Let's see what the next question will bring. From which country comes the discoverer of flammable gas produced by anaerobic conversion of organic material? And what you see is the flag of Tuvalu, which is an island in the Pacific, and it's not from Tuvalu in the Pacific. So is it Belgium, Netherlands, United Kingdom, or France? Discovery of the flammable gas produced by anaerobic conversion. In which country? Ah ha ha, it's Belgium, not the Netherlands. I think we have too many nationalistic Dutch people in the audience. No, it is Belgium. And the inventor was Jan Baptista van Helmont. And he lived in 1580, between 1580 and 1644. So that's a long time ago. And he is also the inventor of the word gas or gas. So you, of course, you didn't know it, but gas is a Dutch word. And gas is also coming from that. And it comes from the Greek word of chaos. And we all know what it means. He did some more interesting experiments, like he grew a tree and looked where the biomass came from, and he concluded that the biomass doesn't come from the soil, but from the water. So he was a real pioneer in a lot of sciences. Interesting person, and very long ago. Okay, let's see what's the score for this one. Frank is leading the pack now. Ooh, and Parachos is just second. It's just a few points difference. Merle is coming closer, and Matti and Korreltje are also coming closer. Yeah, but Parachos has the highest answer streak of the three. Okay, let's see. The next question. In which country was the first officially registered AD plant? So now, people, you have another chance to answer the right question. What you can see here is actually a very old hieroglyphs that depict how to do anaerobic digestion. It's famous from a certain place, because I cannot mention the country, of course. And it may also not be true, because I actually don't know what it means. Oh, there we are, all the answers. And quite a few people are right. Indeed, in India was the first registered anaerobic digestion plant. It was actually built in Mumbai, in a leper colony. And it was, of course, not the first anaerobic process. But even if we look at that, if we look at the first anaerobic process, we can also think that that India may be one of the oldest countries that used anaerobic processes, or else China or the Assyrians. So it has definitely was definitely not in Belgium or the Netherlands that was the with the first AD plant. Let's quickly see who is winning. Oh, this was a question and now there is no score. We have a poll. What do you find the most important factor to guarantee that your project still functions after you leave? So as you can see here, it's an anaerobic digestion project that slightly went wrong. It's actually not in far away from here. It's in Germany. And the options are you find training important, make it foolproof, or the KISS principle, availability for advice, or if it's not your problem, it's not your problem, then it's green. And this is a poll, so there are no scores for this one. And what do you find most important is the training. And that is also interesting, because it's also a nice introduction for Michelle's presentation. So let's see what Michelle has to say about it. And availability for advice is also one person who chose that option as the most important factor. Okay. This is already the last question. It's also a poll. In expanding anaerobic technologies across the globe, what is more important? And you can choose both if you want. So what is more important? Development / implementation of advanced technology, or development or implementation of the environment? And if you make a choice, you also need to click the submit button, because both choices are possible. And it's a poll, so there's no winners or losers in this one. There we are. So people find development and implementation of the environment, so the legal and political and other environmental factors, even more important than development of the technology. And I think that that is indeed very important. That's also it actually shows that it's a pity that we do not have any social science background people around, because the mixture between social science and technology, that is what works best. And this is the last poll. So let's see if we have a winner. Eternal fame for Merle. Merle, you won.
Yeah, but disqualify me, because I submitted two of the questions, so it's not fair.
Yeah, okay, so we have to disqualify Merle. Frank, I'm afraid I have to disqualify you too. Not?
Yeah, that's all right.
So, Parasos, how do you pronounce your name? Can you open your microphone? If not, then you are the winner of the day. And you have the eternal fame, at least for today, for this webinar. Congratulations. I think well done. And the response was really nice. And also the answers were really interesting for us. So thank you for that. And I will give the floor back to the organizers.
Well, thank you, Jacques, for hosting this interesting Kahoot quiz. Gave some interesting insights, and I think we have now enough energy to listen to the presentations of Mr. Michel Otten and Aart van der Beukel. I'm very pleased to introduce Michel Otten. Mr. Otten is Technical Director at Veolia Biofane Industrial Wastewater Treatment Technology in the Asia-Pacific region. He has more than 30 years experience in industrial biological wastewater treatment with a focus on anaerobic technologies. such as UASB and EGSB in several types of industry, specifically in the food and beverage, recycled paper, and specific chemical industry applications. Since 1997, residing in Asia, Mr. Otten has held various positions within Biofane and Veolia, including general and technical management within several business units. Michel, the floor is yours.
Okay. Everybody can hear me, I hope. Now I need to see where is my presentation. Okay, so thank you very much for, first of all, for all the audiences who are attending. And thank you for the invitation to make this presentation for the TAS committee and this webinar. So I'll give a short introduction of my experiences in Southeast Asia, Asia Pacific, with implementation of anaerobic treatment projects. We'll give a short introduction about where I'm coming from and Biotain and Veolia, and then I will refer to the countries where we have done our projects and share with you practical experiences and challenges specific for this region. You have seen some dotted page pictures already of some reference projects in the region. Some are challenging due to location. I will come to that in a moment. So, short introduction for myself. As Carl already introduced me, I work with Biotain since 1992. I'm based in Asia Pacific in 1997. I've been based in Indonesia, China, Singapore, and currently in Malaysia in Kuala Lumpur. I think most of you will know Biotain as one of the pioneers in development of commercial UASB and EGSB technology. Globally, we have been applying our systems and technologies to partners, our own projects, basically since...
Michel, can I interrupt for a short... we see a black square in your presentation. Is it possible to remove that on the lower, just above the lower sentences?
I don't know how to do that. I am full screen.
Okay. If someone knows, then let me know in the chat and I will let you know, or someone else.
And, yes? And I have... My screen is full screen, so I don't see any black bar.
Okay. Yep. If someone knows, then I will let you know. Thank you.
All right. Okay, so just to continue, so Biotain was acquired by Veolia in 2009. Veolia, you may know, is one of the global leading water technology companies. And the group where I'm working for is so-called Veolia Water Technologies, which are the in-house design and engineering group for the parent company as well. And we specialized in water and wastewater treatment solutions for both industrial and municipalities. Obviously, for myself, I purely focus on industrial applications. This is roughly the region where I'm working in. So I'm based roughly in the center in Malaysia. But our territory goes from the north to China to all the way south to Australia and New Zealand. We do have our own offices in several countries, but we also do projects in countries where we don't have our own offices, where we work with partners or directly to end users. To give you an overview of the market segment where we are working in, as Carl mentioned already, typically food and beverage industries, pulp and paper, mostly recycled paper, and specific chemical industries where PTA industry is one of our major market segments. And you can see in the range of countries where we are delivering these kind of projects that basically you have a wide range of cultures, locations, climates, high tech, low tech. So it is a complete mix of all kind of experiences what we do across our projects each time. So that is what I wanted to share with you in more detail. what is really important to realize is sometimes where is the project location. It can be in a very well developed infrastructure, like a country like Singapore, which is basically one big city, or in Australia in a major city area. But it can also be somewhere in the middle of nowhere. And in the picture in the map I showed Indonesia, just to give you an idea how big the country is, you can fly for 3.5-4 hours and you are still within the same country. China is quite similar. You have several project locations which are far away from where you are actually based. What I mentioned already, the climates can play a role, the design aspect for climate, very cold winter climate in China to tropical, wet, humid in the tropics. They have different requirements in what you deliver, what you design for. Very important is, in my opinion, the availability. It depends on the project location, obviously, of tools and materials. And sometimes you are really in the middle of nowhere where there is no hardware shop, where you cannot just go quickly buy some cables or tie wraps or other tools, and then you are lost. So you need to think forward in these kind of projects to make sure that you really supply all your components, all your tools, all your installation material well up front before the site construction and installation work starts. Cultures I mentioned already. We are working in a very diverse environment, regionals, from Western countries, Australia, Chinese-based countries, Singapore is predominantly Chinese, Taiwan, China, Muslim-based countries, Malaysia, Indonesia, but we also work in Pakistan, for example, Malaysia, Indonesia, they have their own specifics. So you need to be aware of where is your project and which people are going to handle these projects. Be aware of the language. Definitely not everybody speaks and understands English the way we are speaking it now. Maybe at a higher management level in a company, yes. But don't expect that your operator of the wastewater treatment plant is fluent in English. So that brings challenges with itself in operator training, for example, passing of proper manuals. Sometimes we need to prepare the manuals in the local languages. There are all specific requirements for the countries where we are doing our business. Then we have technical standards or technical differences. We are often confronted with very different type of technical standards from DIN and ANSI, which are quite common also in Europe. But we also have JIS, a Japanese standard. GB is in China. Australia is very specific in their electrical design standards. So again, you need to be aware of that. Where is the project? Where is the location? What are the requirements for the project? Because that can also be quite different from the type of industry you are working in. Whether it is a high-tech chemical industry, which typically follows oil and gas standards, up to a local food and beverage company, which maybe applies no standard at all, as long as you make it work. So that can be quite a big differentiation in how you design and how you deliver your project. The last two topics are really related to staff. That is really significant. Depends a little bit on the economical situations, of course. But staff turnover is significant. We need to do our best to keep our people, especially the good people, obviously. But also on our client side, I have experienced a project where the client project manager changed three times within the project. So that is can be a challenge as such as well. And referring to staff quality, in this case, I'm more referring to the client side. Don't expect that they will make available highly qualified and educated staff among the wastewater treatment plant operator team. So that brings challenges again in how do you hand over your project, your operator training, stay close to the client after your handover, during your warranty period. Make sure that you stay in touch with those people and try to guide them as good as you can. My next sheet, some of the additional challenges what I see, what I find specifically in the tender stage. There are so many updates sometimes from the client side that you need to be really patient before you finally reach the consensus with the client. This is the design basis, and this is the basis for our new project. My personal principle, I just saw it in the Kahoot quiz as well, keep it simple, but make sure it works, make it foolproof. I think that's really important when you deliver projects, specifically in, let's say, remote areas where specifically the operator staff is not the most educated, I would say. You really need to have a foolproof system and not too fancy, not too many high-tech controls and things like that. Keep it simple, keep it straightforward. What I mentioned before, the locations, the remote locations specifically, in your budgeting, be aware of what is locally available. Are there local materials, subcontractors available in that location? Or do you need to bring your normal subcontractor from the big city to that remote area? That happened to us in a few projects. Logistics schedules, cost for transport, be aware of that. Make sure that you get quotes up front and that you don't get surprised during the project. Last but not least, motivation of your own staff is sometimes an issue. When you are doing projects in truly remote locations where there is very limited, I would say, social life after work. Basically, you live in a campsite and you stay there 3-4 months until the project is installed, commissioned and started. That can be a challenge sometimes for your staff to make them really motivated to do that kind of a job. And then, I think that's my summary sentence. We need to adapt, same as anaerobic bacteria. They also always need to adapt to a new substrate. We need to adapt ourselves, not only myself, but your whole staff, to work in these kind of conditions, this kind of region where you are confronted with diverse cultures, different habits. Be aware of food requirements sometimes. Because we have an office in Jakarta, for example, in Indonesia, where most of the people are Muslim staff. You need to be aware of that if you send them overseas to a country where, for example, halal food is difficult available. And then you will see them packing their suitcase with full of noodles and other things what they can bring. So that is what I wanted to share with you. I only have 15 minutes, so I believe I have reached my last sheet already. So I would like to say thank you for your attention, and I believe now we go to the Q&A session. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Michel. Thank you for your very interesting presentation. Thank you for sharing your experiences in the Asia Pacific region. And indeed, we have now some time for some Q&A. So I would like to ask the participants to ask their questions in the chat, and then it will be communicated to me, and then we go from there. So do we have already a first question?
Yes, the girl, I already sent it forward to you. So, okay. Nico, yeah. There is a message.
Yes, we have a question from Nico Groeneveld. Many obstacles, challenges and problems to solve within a project. But how do you start acquire a project? Is it only from tenders? Can you give an example? Is the question clear to you, Michel?
It's I see where it is coming from. To give a very basic background, when I started in Indonesia, early 70s, 1997, that was when I moved to Indonesia. Of course, I'm Dutch. There is a long history of Dutch business relations with Indonesia. So what was a very good access is the Dutch community, because there are several Dutch companies active in Indonesia. And to be honest, I think I can mention the name. One of our first projects was the Famelle Mentos Candy project in Indonesia, which was a Dutch company at that time. Now they are merged with Perfetti. But that is networking, I would say receptions, embassy cocktails, chambers of commerce. That is where you find very suitable contacts without looking for public tenders, for example. Because if you wait for a public tender, typically you are too late for being involved in the tender. Then it is already pre-cooked by somebody else. So I hope that answers the question a little bit. I would say networking is more important, I would say, than looking and waiting for tenders to come to you.
Thank you very much, Michel, for your answer. That's clear.
Okay, we have another question. It's from Aart van der Beukel, our second speaker of today. Thanks, Michel. How do you monitor quality operational targets in multiple locations? Can you do that remotely? And I would like to invite Aart and also other people who ask questions to turn on their video and their microphone, so they can also participate in the discussion.
Okay. Yeah, okay. So here I am. I did not open my camera before, I think. Yeah, of course, that's a challenge, Aart. It's a good question. In this particular case, I would say we are fortunate that in the Veolia structure, we have quite a wide network of our own offices, where of course we have local staff and they are involved in the projects in those particular countries. The challenges are more, especially under the current COVID condition, where we do projects, ongoing projects, where we don't have a local presence. And that is really a challenge at this moment to give clear instructions to our clients, partners, people who are involved in the country by very extensive manuals, for example, very huge amount of pictures. We almost make manuals which look like an IKEA brochure, or how do you call it, like an IKEA instruction manual. A lot of pictures, drawings, assembly drawings, because we cannot be there. And typically what we do now, what you normally do on site, like a toolbox meeting every day. So when the client is reaching a certain milestone in their project execution phase, and we are not able to supervise that directly on the site, we have something like what we have today, like a hangout call, or this is Microsoft Meeting or Zoom. And we sit together virtually with the people involved from the client side, from our side, and we share what we want to share in that call. And that is coming more and more regular in terms of trying to control quality from remote. So that's the situation we have at this moment. And maybe you have the same situation, I don't know. You do your projects in West Africa, I understand, but you're currently in the Netherlands.
Yeah, no, I'll get to that. Yeah. Thanks, yeah, clear.
Okay.
So yeah, I hope that answers the question.
Okay, thank you, Michel, for addressing the question of Aart. Aart, can I ask you to turn off your mic and your video, then we go to the next question. It's of Jacques van de Vossenberg. If unexpected costs like transport exist, and if the budget is tight, is it still profitable? So more about the economics of the projects.
Yeah, of course not. But what can you do? Yeah, the most recent practical example that we were shipping goods from Europe, and this stupid container ship got stuck. And we got an email from the freight forwarder that there is going to be additional cost incurred. Well, thank you. what can you do?
Yeah, but if you foresee those issues, then you can also say no to a project, of course, because you cannot.
No, I mean, this was a project in progress. So, of course, they always, unexpected surprises sometimes. But that's what you need to look for, forecasting your budget and make sure that you, first of all, are still competitive enough to win the project. Carl knows all about that as well. And second, make sure that you still have some contingency and some fat somewhere in your budget to cover for these unexpected events. Fortunately, I think the older you get, the wiser you get, and you get a little bit more accurate in your true estimates. And that means that your final budget estimate, let's say for the true out-of-pocket cost, is spot on, as good as you can. And then you can build in your safety margin and be competitive to win the projects. But again, it requires exactly what you say. You need to be able to anticipate over this project in this location, this country, be aware this and this could happen, or this kind of surprise could pop up. And that, that's my benefit, I guess. I'm starting to get gray hair, so that it shows.
Yeah, you become wiser.
And, old and wise. Yeah.
Michel, I get some comments. Yeah,
experience comes with, what was it? Wasted tools. I think that was the expression.
Michel, a comment of Nico Groeneveld. He said, is it possible to insure yourself against such unexpected costs?
Ooh, that's difficult. Eh? If this truly force majeure, then I think you can claim that from your project insurance. But if it is, let's say, just a commercial impact, due to the current COVID, suddenly the shipping costs are going up due to, I don't know, I still don't really understand it. I guess there's less ships sailing. You cannot forecast that in your budget, that suddenly the rate is increased by 30%. Yeah, so you need to take it. Of course, you can try to explore other freight forwarders in this particular case. But sometimes you have no choice but to accept.
Yeah.
And you don't have an insurance for that. Yeah, our insurance is our head office in Paris. They have a lot of money in the bank. But other than that, not really available.
Okay, thank you, Michel. Do we have other questions from other participants? We have other questions to Michel Otten. So if not, then I would thank again Michel for his very interesting presentation and for addressing the questions asked. And then I would like to introduce to you Mr. Aart van den Beukel. You already saw him in the discussion. Right. Mr. Aart van den Beukel is Managing Director and Founder of Savisana Holding LTD. The vision of Savisana is making sanitation and waste treatment affordable for low to middle income countries. The company sees waste as a resource to create value. Savisana has developed several circular business models for local wastewater treatment for governments, utilities, and food processing industries. Mr. Van den Beukel is an experienced managing director with a demonstrated history of working in the renewables and environmental industry. He is a strong business development professional skilled in biomass, rural development, management, renewable energy and biogas. Mr. Van den Beukel, can I ask you to take the floor?
Yeah, thanks, Carl. That's a very good introduction. Very nice. Yes, okay. Thank you. Yeah, so my name is Aart van den Beukel. I'm here based in a place called Weesp, close to Amsterdam. So based in the Netherlands. The project that we're going to show you here is based in Ghana. And I will give you a bit of an insight in the operations there. And I think the most interesting part perhaps for this session is to talk a bit about the experience that we have from running that project and the lessons learned. So let's go to the first, to the second slide. Yeah, so I wanted to start off with the problems when I started in Ghana 10 years ago. It started basically from fecal sludge problems that are ongoing in Accra. So we are close to Accra, working in a slum area of about 300,000 people. And the first thing I noticed is that most of the waste, the fecal sludge waste, ends up in the ocean. As you can see here, this is a dump site that was used by the municipality in Accra. And about 90, it's even slightly higher than 90%, ends up in the environment. So it's not treated. There is a sewage treatment plant in Accra, which is not functional. They have renewed it, so there is something in place now, but also not fully functional. So it is a big problem. And that was basically the starting point for Saifisana to think about a solution. So next slide. Yeah, so I will talk about a bit about the model, but in essence, it's that we wanted to find a way to look at fecal sludge and find ways to make it more affordable and to also claim ownership of the treatment. So not just act as a consultant and to advise how to technically solve it, but also become an operator. And in order to do so, you need to cover your costs. So one of the biggest things we looked at is, firstly, again, the technical solution using an AD, an anaerobic digester that you can see here in the picture, but also to find ways to control your cost and to find other sources of income to basically cover your daily cost to operate and to maintain your system, including replacing the necessary parts. And as Saifisana here in Amsterdam, we try to, apart from this one, now look at different locations. That's what we're aiming for. Firstly, in Ghana, and we're also now looking in for a bigger project also in Mali. So I think one other thing to mention is that Saifisana, again, is not a consultancy firm, but we try to look at it from a perspective of design to build and to operate the system for a longer period of time. And this contract here in Ghana is for 15 years. Next slide, please. Yeah, so here in a linear way, you can see how we want to operate. So we collect fecal sludge from toilets in the area, and also food waste is added in the processing plant. One of the first things we had to find out is about how to find the right mix of the two, how to combine them to basically optimize the output. As you can see here, the focus is on biofertilizer, and the other one is electricity, and irrigation water is something we're still testing with. We've done some work on site, but that's not commercial yet. So fertilizer is sold to the farmers in the area, and we have a power purchase agreement with the power company in Accra, in Ghana. So we sell per kilowatt hour, and then of course further down the chain, people will use it for fresh food production and consumer electricity. And as you can also see here, we currently work with the local municipality, but also more and more of the industries are interested. And then going back basically to close the loop to the front again in food waste. So we have a contract now with Nestlé, with Unilever. And we just signed a contract with Danone to work with their waste streams and to further close the loop. Next slide, please. Yeah, so I will quickly run through these just to give you a bit of an impression what it looks like. So as Michel said, for the system that they use, is simplicity is essence. We've made some changes in the designs in the past years. This is the intake for fecal sludge. And you can also see in the end that in the back of the picture that we are adding the organic waste to it. So it's the mixing that's taking place here. So we have about 8 to 10 fecal sludge trucks coming in a day to dump their waste. Next slide. And again, this one, you've seen it. Yeah? So in an intake, it's blended together, and the digester that you see in the back has a capacity of approximately like 2,500 cubic meter. Which is about the capacity to run a CHP unit, a generator for 100 kilowatts that we're now going to double in capacity this year. Next slide. Yeah, and as I said, fertilizer is an important product for us. So it's in a process of treating your fecal sludge, or the mix with fecal sludge and organic waste is then dried and co-composted. And this is a separate brand that we've put in the market. It's certified, and yeah, it's one of the streams of income that we get to cover the operational cost. Yes. Next slide, please. And here you see, this is Gloria, one of our colleagues, who is measuring the amount of kilowatt hours that are produced per month, and we send an invoice to the power company. And we are billed, so we bill them, and we get paid every month for the supply that we've done. Yes, next slide. Well, some of the this is a slide through, so the experiences that we've seen. I will touch upon a few topics. We only have a limited time, but if you go to the, if you click, you will see the first one. Yes, Carla, can you click it? Yeah, scaling. So in terms of scaling, so like I said, we've done this program in Ashaiman, in the slum that we work, where we work. We're now looking at new markets. So I think knowing your market is, of course, essential. So we're not just a consultant, but we want to invest. And therefore, knowing your market is crucial. And yeah, and also having the right local partners to help you with that, because we are newcomers, and without a local smart partner, we can't do that. So that's one of the first things I would say that we invest a lot of time in, and to maintain that contact as well. Then the offtake agreements, that took us a long time. That is the power purchase agreement that we, it took us almost about a year. We are the first waste to energy plant in West Africa. So for the power company, it was a relatively new experience. So negotiating the contract was a big hurdle. And well, we have some experience in how to do that now. But yeah, as you can imagine, that it's that's not an easy process. And also because we are a relatively a small player. So like normally PPAs, they run from about 1 megawatt. And we are now only going to 200 kilowatts. So you can imagine that that's a different story altogether. Then regulation permits. I was, when we started, we thought, well, let's just build something and of course look at the local regulation, but getting your right permits for not just for construction, but for basically operating as a waste processor, as a fertilizer production company, as a power company, they all have to be in place. And of course, separate to that, you have the certificates. That for the specifically for the compost now, and you have to acquire those, and these are processes that from both parties, from ourselves and also from the government institutions, has not always been very clear. So it's a very time consuming complex process, especially in the beginning when we started, when renewable energy had just started, and and we are the first operator. Sourcing year round is one of the, I would say, challenges for us. You can imagine that without proper, consistent, sufficient supplies, your system will not instantly break down, but I mean, stop working, but you will see flaws in your system and then also in your business case. So first of all, finding the right blend of your fecal sludge and the types of organic waste that we can source is critical. And also we experienced that over the years that not just the climate change so much, but more the seasonal changes also has an impact on the quality of waste and also on the production levels, and then again on the business case. And so that's not just for the energy production, but also for the compost production. So now we have a better grip on that, more able to plan ahead, have more storage capacity, etc., and finding the right suppliers. Yeah, well, building teams, Michel also talked about that. That's your asset, your biggest asset. And first of all, finding the right people is not always easy. And keeping them in and keeping the right mentality in the group and enthusiasm to run this, because in a way we were a startup or we are a startup, and you need to motivate people even if things don't run properly. And how do you do that? Because I'm here in the Netherlands, we have a team of 8 based here in Amsterdam, and we have a team of 30 there. So in the early years, we went back and forth. Like every month, you go there to motivate and to explain, to train, etc. And that's something really to work on. And I can really say that after in the past 2-3 years now, it's much more stable, and we found ways to motivate and to train, of course, working with partners on that. We can't just do it ourselves. So that was a very important part of the success now in Ghana. Yes. Well, some of the lessons learned also here, I picked out a few. If you can go to the first one, design, build and operate. That's something that is very important. So if you design, or basically if you operate, you need to know what should be the design. And and I think still we are learning every year. We learn new things. And it's not a very straightforward. It's not some design that you pick from a shop and how to do that. So it's learning very practical things, and because also you want to keep it simple, you really have to be on top of it and learn and how to improve that in the new design, in the new plant that we want to install. And that also applies for your standard operating procedures, of course. The local ownership and buy-in, that's a decision we made a few years ago that it should not be an expat-run business. So it should not be that we are there basically to lead, because that will slow down the scaling of Savisana. So having the local leadership is very critical, having the right local partners and invest time in them to be able to do it. And the local ownership, like I said, also in the supply chain, that people are committed. Why are they supplying to you, and why are they willing to continue doing that in the years to come, has been very essential. And I'm not sure if I put that in the list here, but the topic about quality control is of course essential. And so we, from day one, we started setting up a data monitoring system, so we can actually log in from here to the plant in Ghana, so we can see from the energy part, from composting, etc., all the processes basically there. We can visualize them on the screen, and that helps. I mean, you don't control it, but you can assist the team locally to improve the process, or to look at failures in the system, or to plan ahead of maintenance and those kind of things. Yes, please. Well, keep it simple. There you go. So Michel talked about it as well. Keep it simple. Too simple doesn't work. So and that was in the past 2 years, we've made some modifications where we said initially, let's do it manually instead of mechanically. Later, we are now making some changes still make it mechanized. But the human factor also remains important. And of course, the parts that we use, or the equipment that we use, has to be locally available, or part of it. And not because of the parts just like that, but also the level of service that you can get locally is very limited, especially for CHP and rock digestion proved to be quite a constraint. And even we had to find people from Unilever who used to have their own digester system, had to track them back and see if they could be of support. So that simplicity is key. Yes, please. Oh, here it is. So the data support system for remote support. I talked about it already. Next one. And the people. Yeah, so training the people is essential. Building your right organizational chart, like what kind of functions do you need in the operations. They tend to, in the beginning stages, people tend to ask for more people. We need more people. And so how do you get your efficiency? Just more people won't make the business run. So, but finding that right balance has been something we looked at. And working with recruiting agencies and so on. And scouting through the network locally has been very important. I think this was my last point. Here you see the team. So I had to pick out a few topics, but if there's more questions, feel free to ask them, and I will try to answer it. Thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you, Art. Thank you for this very interesting presentation. It's very interesting to see that you not only give advice, but that you really implement as a company, that you design the plants, that you build the plants, and that you also operate the plant. So what I see from your presentation is that you really make the difference in Ghana. So congratulations with that.
Thank you. Yeah.
We have the first question in. I see the question from Jacques van der Vossenberg. Jacques, maybe you can put on your... Yes, you are already there. Actually, to both Aart and Michel, how do you guarantee continuation as soon as you leave?
Yeah.
Maybe I can invite Michel also to put on his microphone and video to join this discussion.
Yep, I'm back. I'm still here.
Can you comment?
Maybe I should start with the answer because I think it is more directed to me because we are really leaving when we hand over the plant and of course Aart is not doing that. He is operating his own plant, so
yeah,
he is
never
leaving. Yeah,
but after 15 years, then it's done with Aart, isn't it?
Yeah, 15 years. Yeah.
Aart, yeah.
I'm not that long in the business yet.
okay.
Yeah, no, I think what, of course, at a certain point in the project delivery for, let's say from our side, yeah, we don't operate. Or yes, Veolia operates, but typically not in the industrial market. Typically they operate in the municipal market, drinking water plants or sewage treatment plants, also with AD for sludge treatment. That is where they do design, build and operate kind of projects. But in the industrial market, very seldom that they are doing that. So yes, there is always a point for us where we hand over. We get our, normally our final acceptance, we get our final payment and then we pass our warranty period. And yeah, then it depends a little bit on the client itself. And of course, from our side, how intensive remains the contact. And that's then again very local, where, for example, our local team in Thailand or in Indonesia, they stay very close with the clients who we have worked for. So for them, it's very easy to pick up the phone, how is it going, or interactive, basically. But there are also projects and countries where you seldom hear anything anymore. So I'm not sure where that what is the true reason for that. I think it's mostly, I would say, client related. How close do they stay with us, the people who were involved in the project? And if they're open and come with, hey, I have a small question like this, of course, then we help them and we answer them. That's how we stay in touch. And yeah, I'm not sure whether that really answers your question. There's not really a formal mechanism for it.
Yeah, but it's just for me because I wonder. I've seen so many projects going wrong after they finished, and I think that it's good to have a focus on that. And of course, your focus is more business-like, but Aart is also a bit, what do you call, because you want to do it. It's a bit, no, not NGO, but a bit more from the heart, like way. I don't say it's not in biothane, but
no, yeah, of course it's in my heart, anaerobic treatment, but sure I work for a commercial company.
Yeah
and the business needs to make money. That's simple as that.
Yeah,
but again, what I mentioned, I cannot really see a pattern why some... I'm not saying when we are not in contact that the projects are not working well. There are several examples where, of course, when it goes wrong, I think the client will contact us.
Yeah.
Typically, they will do that. And if you don't hear anything, typically it's good, no news, good news.
Yeah. And Aart, so how do you deal with that?
Yeah, so I can't say yet. We've been running the bigger plan now for 4 years, so we're not there yet. But the essence for us is not to step out. And of course, now we have a contract for 15 years. But ideally, we stay. At least the assumption is that we stay there. We are there to operate, because if we don't, we fear that it will fail instantly. And of course, we've started some small discussions now with the municipality. What if in say 10 years or 11 years from now, we would hand over? And would you still work under a certain of a license or service license? That's something to look at. But we can't just step away. It will definitely not work. Or not, yeah. It's very likely to fail.
Okay.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you both, Michel and Aart, for answering the question. We have another question of Nico Groeneveld. Is Savisana also working to improve the institutional side in Ghana of wastewater treatment?
Yeah, that's a very good one. So when we started, we worked with the African Development Bank, and one of the things we wanted to do and needed to do is to set up a steering committee. And for me, that initially was very political, and I thought, yeah, why do we have to do that? It will slow down the process, etc. But in the end, it proved to be vital for the success of the project. And so it basically opened up the information both for us and for them. So we learned about their policies from Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Energy, Ministry of Finance, of course, and Ministry of Sanitation, to better understand what we need to make it successful, and same for them. And that's when the discussion started. And after some time, we closed that whole steering committee because we were more commercially operating. And now we revived that this year to do the same, because we feel that it's not moving anywhere in Ghana in the sense of fecal sludge treatment specifically. And we also had discussions with them. And well, the essence is that they are not too sure how to solve their problem. And so we said, okay, why don't we just revive those communications and talk about that, how we can be of help and how others can be of help. Because for us, it's not just Savisana, it can be any player, but how can we help to solve these problems together? Yeah, and for example, and a very important discussion is about the economics. What kind of cost is involved in the treatment, and what can we do to lower the cost?
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
We have another question from Jules van Lier. Jules, you can open your mic. Maybe you can ask your question yourself. Otherwise, I will.
I think it's now open. I did something.
Yeah.
Probably it's open.
You're in.
Okay. Well, thanks for your great talk, Aart. I liked it very much. In fact, you mentioned it briefly, this anaerobic reactor, which is standing there as a sewage treatment plant. In fact, we designed it, and it was constructed by Taylor Woodrow in that time. And it was it worked perfectly as long as the Brits were there, and it worked for 2 years perfectly. And then the Brits pulled back, and then it collapsed rapidly. It was a classical development at program, and yeah, what was in fact lacking was the complete ownership at the client of this plant. They didn't know what to do with it. So that's why I like very much your approach in Ghana. But you also mentioned that well, if you pull out now, then you also you question yourself whether it will sustain.
Yeah.
So my question is, can you identify what is your exact role as Dutch guy? And maybe there are more Dutch guys, to sustain what you now have, and how can this be diminished? Can this be replaced by Ghanaians? So to enhance further the ownership of what you have built there.
Yeah, I think, well, so the initial phase, let's ignore the initial phase, because everybody was learning how to get there, and even ourselves, how to build something like that. Now it's there, and now we have a 100% Ghana local team. And I dare to say that that they can manage it. And now the question is, how can we then build capacity locally in a stronger way? And we are, a social business, so we're not making a lot of money from these things. So we need to work with our investors to find ways to invest in that part. So if we want a new program, we're now looking at Kumasi and another place. So if we want to develop something there, it will be much more in the hands of the local team than from our hands, of course. We will help assist in the design. We will not build a design team or develop as a design team in Ghana, but a team that can operate multiple locations, definitely. And I think then the only role that we will have is more remote support monitoring if it becomes a bit too technical. So you don't want to have high skilled people there because you don't need them full time. But together with your partners here, so we're also working with, well, for example, Roy Haskoning, but also with Westwaternet, they can also support here and there with some smart advice that is, well, needed once or twice a year. And so it's now about building the local capacity. So I think it can be done, but still you will need some kind of support and again, ownership. So it's not about Ghanaians or not Ghanaians, it's about who is willing to own and take the risk. And we have investors that are willing to to risk, and that's of course our benefit, and we can do that.
All right. Okay. Okay. That's promising. Thank you. Yeah. Makes sense. Thank you.
We have an additional question on this topic from Jacques van de Vossenberg, and maybe you have already addressed it already a little bit, Aart. But is your Ghanaian staff already so experienced and trained that they are able to train other staff?
So they are very hands-on, very practical in how it works on site. So they have a huge looking at this. Yes, we have somebody for sourcing. He knows exactly how it works in the municipality and how to sign the contracts and how to develop the contracts. We have a plant manager that knows exactly how to run the place. We have the SOPs in place, so everything is there. So for example, we are looking at other locations. One is now in Mali, and we are now actually discussing who can go there to hand over some of the skills that they can use there. We're not at that stage yet where we are designing the process, but we are now already considering how to do that in the best way. So I would say we are in the middle of it. They know a lot, but how do you then train somebody else? That can be another skill that you need to have. But in terms of understanding, owning the knowledge, it's there, and they know how to do it.
Okay, thank you. Then I have for myself one final question to you, Aart. If you talk about business models, how difficult is it to develop healthy and circular business models in low to middle income countries? Are you very dependent on governmental support, governmental subsidies?
Yeah, that's another essential point that's a very interesting topic as well, of course. So let's say if for a business model, you need to have two things, or you have two cost components. One is your operational costs, including your capital, your replacement, so your maintenance, but also your initial investment. So for Savisana, the first thing we want to cover is the operational cost to make sure that once it's there, it runs forever, basically, including replacement of parts. But the components that cannot be covered by our business case 100% is the initial investment. So if you need to invest 5 million to set up a plant like this, you will still need some kind of government support. And so that will still be there. And of course, that's the challenge, because what government does to have that kind of money available? Our investors are willing to step in, but still you will need some kind of a fee for service. So you will need to charge a treatment fee, for example. And that's something now for the Mali case we are also discussing with the local utility. And so we can do it for a much lower price, of course, because we can cover the cost for the operations, but the initial investment has to be somehow covered. And you don't want to be just dependent on the subsidies that are there in the market. And also we don't want to be too dependent on tenders, because for us that's going to be take too much time to basically sit back and wait till there's a proper fecal slide treatment thing. So it is, I think the straightforward answer is it's very difficult. It's a very difficult case. And it's something that is a high priority for us to explain to investors, to international finance organizations, how it works.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah. I don't think there are any other questions. Thank you again, Aart. Thank you again, Michel. Before closing this webinar, I want to ask the participants to share with us some ideas on possible topics for a next webinar or for a next symposium. Topics in the field of anaerobic wastewater treatment, in the field of international projects, international business. So please share your ideas with us in the chat, and we can include them in our plans. We now come to the end of this webinar, and if it is all right with Mr. Otten and Mr. Van de Beugel, Michel and Aart, the presentations will be presented and published at the website of KNW. So please check out the KNW website. I want to thank again our speakers for two very interesting presentations. I want to thank you all for participating in this webinar, and I want to thank the organizing committee and the team of KMW for organizing this very interesting webinar. Please follow our communication channels on LinkedIn and on the KMW website. You see here the slide. And for more information. So thank you very much. Stay safe and until the next event. Thank you and goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.